students. Today we are going to discuss about the white lesions of the oral cavity. Myself, Dr. Saithi, Team MDS Conquer. So this is a basic classification of the white lesions. So as if we have just have an idea of what all lesions come under the individual classification, that's more than enough. Actually, almost all the diseases or these lesions we have covered in the red lesions and the disease of the skin and also in the infectious part. So which I've missed there, I'll be covering here. So remember the normal variations, which all come under developmental, which all come under genetic, traumatic, infectious, mucocutaneous, pre-malignant, tumors and miscellaneous. So have an idea of the classification, especially the red and white lesions. Have a good idea of the classification first. Okay, so the developmental is already discussed, the genetic is already discussed in the disease of the skin, the traumatic thing is already discussed, the infectious is discussed in the bacterial, viral and fungal infections, the mucocutaneous is also discussed. So again, which I've missed, I'll be continuing here. So coming to the normal variants, that is the linear alba, which appears as a white line over the line of occlusion. So it seen as a whitish line exactly over the line of occlusion. It is a normal variant. It is also called as linear alba buccalis. It is seen in every alternate individual. It is a common white lesion, which is a normal thing. Next is a leukedema, which also is seen as a whitish area over the buccal mucosa, which disappears on stretching. So it disappears on stretching. Even this is a normal variant. The third one is the Fordyce granules, which can be seen as a whitish or yellowish spots over the buccal mucosa. So these three are the normal variants which are seen as white lesions. So coming to the lichen planus, as I said, it's an autoimmune chronic mucocutaneous. The etiology, as I said, it is a T-cell mediated disease. So oral lichen planus, and it's again divided as six types: the reticular, the erosive, the desquamated gingivitis, the papular, the plaque lights and bullous. So all these types, actually the reticular type shows typical white lesion. The others have red and white because it shows reddish erythematous area but peripheral striae. Okay, so the malignancy, very important, is the rate of transmission is 0.4 to 5. So this you have to remember for lichen planus. So coming to its histology, it shows hyperkeratosis, civet bodies and sawtooth reticulum. So next is the psoriasis. Even this shows a white lesion. So especially the scaly thing will be there. And as psoriasis, again, it can be associated with geographic tongue. So this is the differential diagnosis. So it shows elongated reticulum and Monroe's abscess. So scaly, dry, scaly keratotic lesions are seen in psoriasis. So coming to the oral cavity, it shows a geographic tongue. So next is actinic keratitis, also called as actinic keratosis or solar keratosis. It is a pre-malignant lesion with directly related to sun exposure, actinic keratitis. So here you can see a white lesion over the vermilion border of the lip and also seen on the other sun exposed areas of the skin. So histopathologically, since it has malignant potential, it can show dysplastic features like altered nucleocytoplasmic ratio, loss of cellular polarity, cellular atypia, and about 10% can show malignant transformation. So very important is actinic keratitis. Even this is included under white lesions of the oral cavity. So next is the tobacco pouch keratosis, also called as snuff dippers keratosis, very important. So wherever the patient has a habit of putting its tobacco, there it ends up with a white lesion. High keratosis will be there, it ends up with a white lesion. So the smokeless tobacco produces carcinogens, which is this, that is N-nitrosone nicotine, which is very important, and it causes mucosal alterations. So the clinical features shows a white lesion, especially the area where the patient has a habit of contact. Immediately to the area of contact, the patient will end up with a white lesion, and also the gingival recession and the periodontal destruction is also seen in that area. So coming to its histological feature, even this is actually a pre-malignant thing, so it has a malignant potentiality, and epithelium is hyperkeratotic and thickened with a characteristic evacuation and edema. So habit cessation is the only treatment, first treatment for that, and also you can put him on antioxidants like lycopene. Next, palatal lesion associated reverse smoking. Some patients have a habit of reverse smoking. So initial lesions appear to be white. So they put the lit end part of the cigarette into the mouth, wherein the starting lesions appear to be white. So even this comes under white lesions. So coming to the OSMF, you know, OSMF is the main etiological features of OSMF, that is oral submucous fibrosis, wherein there is increased deposition of the fibers, and it's mainly because of the causative agent, that is the betel nut, which is present, and it's one of the most etiological agent, and others include the nutritional deficiency and hypersensitivity to chili peppers. So the inflammatory response will release a cytokine which causes the proliferation of the fibroblast and regulates the collagen synthesis and down-regulating the collagenase production. So collagenase is decreased and collagen production is increased, and it increases the deposition of the fibers. So the clinical features, as we know, the initial clinical features, the burning sensation of the mouth and also pale oral mucosa. The patient will have inability to open the mouth because of the increased deposition of the fibers and causing trismus. And also the soft palate is deviated and it is shrunken. At times it gives a hockey stick appearance and depapillation of the tongue, altered taste sensation, xerostomia or excessive salivation. All these are the different clinical features of OSMF. So staging is there. Early OSMF shows mild blanching of oral mucosa, no restriction in mouth opening, no restriction in tongue protrusion, and with maximally extended mouth opening and burning sensation is there. So in early OSMF, the patient shows only burning sensation and mild blanching, whereas in moderate OSMF, it shows moderate and severe blanching. Mouth opening is reduced by 33%, even sound tongue protrusion is reduced by 33%, and burning sensation even in absence of stimuli. Palpable bands will be there, lymphadenopathy can be there, and anemia on hematological examination. Coming to the severe form, more than 66% in mouth reduction, cheek flexibility, the patient cannot blow his cheek, we cannot pull his cheeks like this. So all these are the different stages which are seen in OSMF, and that 66% reduction is there in third stage. Ulcers can also be seen. The palpable bands are there, the vertical bands over the buccal mucosa and circular bands over the labial mucosa, and also the others like nutritional deficiencies and bilateral lymphadenopathy can be seen. So the staging also very important for OSMF. They can ask 33% reduction in which stage, severe burning sensation with thick palpable and ulcers are seen in which stage. So they can ask, we have to have a good idea of these three stages. So malignant potential is 4 to 13%, whereas for lichen planus, it is 0.4 to 5%. So remember this. Next is histological feature. So histologically, it shows increased deposition with chronic inflammatory cells and collagen deposition, and hyperkeratosis is also seen. So very important, submucosal deposition, which is dense collective connective tissue with inflammatory cells, is very important. So anemia is the first differential diagnosis for oral mucosa because of the pallor and blanching of the oral mucosa. Iron deficiency anemia shows the blanching and pallor oral mucosa. So first differential diagnosis for oral submucosal fibrosis is anemia. So coming to the leukoplakia, which is also a white lesion, which can be homogeneous, which can be speckled, and which can be varicose. So any of these types shows a white lesion. So homogeneous shows a typical cracked mud appearance. Even the speckled, it shows both red and white, that is like erythroplakia, and the varicose shows papillary projections and shows cauliflower like appearance. So other subtype is a proliferative varicose leukoplakia, which you can see it has high risk to convert into dysplasia. So next is a squamous papilloma, which is caused by HPV virus. Even this shows a typical white lesion, and it's seen on the tongue, lips and the soft palate. So squamous cell carcinoma, we know the, even that shows a typical white lesion with erythematous areas. The leukoplatic, which is convert, the leukoplakia squamous cell carcinoma also shows a white lesion. So common site, you can note it down. So varicose carcinoma, other names, which is also called as acrimens tumor or snug dippers cancer. So the common sites are buccal mucosa, alveolar ridge, and all these are the common site. Even this shows as a typical cauliflower lesion. So even it is included under the white lesions of oral cavity. So the main how to differentiate from squamous cell carcinoma is it shows deep cleft like interpapillary spaces. So this is an important histological feature. It shows perikeratinous covering that extends into deep cleft like interpapillary spaces. Very important. So lichenoid reactions, again, this is also one of the thing which is included under white lesions. The lichenoid reactions is usually unilateral, whereas lichen planus is bilateral. These lichenoid reactions can occur due to hypersensitivity to the constituents derived from amalgams or composite resins or cobalt or any other flavoring agents in the food. So it is usually unilateral and it also shows striae. And also the drugs can cause this lichenoid reactions, which includes all these drugs: anti-parasitics, anti-hypertensive, anti-arthritics, and anti-anxiety drugs, NSAIDs, oral hypoglycemic, uricosuric drugs. All these are the different drugs which can cause lichenoid reactions. So in lichenoid reactions can also occur in graft versus host disease. So if, for example, if a patient is taking any bone graft from other like other patient or from other source, even it is treated as a foreign body, and it can result in an immune response which can result in a white lesion, which is called as a lichenoid reaction. So this is seen in allogenic bone transplantation. So the pathogenesis is, it is anti-antigen dependent proliferation of transplanted donor T lymphocytes, which actually vary genetically from the recipient tissues, which give rise to a generation of effector cells that destroy the recipient tissue. So it is actually, the pathogenesis is the proliferation of the T lymphocytes, which damage the recipient tissues and which finally ends up with the clinical presentation. So clinically, and also it shows a white lesions. So oral lesions and graft versus host disease, and also salivary and lacrimal epithelium may also be involved. So lichenoid reactions both can affect both skin and mucous membrane. So recurrent aphthous, actually it appears as a erythematous area, but at times it's seen as a whitish slough around, surrounded by a erythematous halo. So recurrent aphthous stomatitis can also be seen as a classic white lesion surrounded by erythematous halo.